the Seed Savers helper now.
And where did they come from?
The two big ones, they're from Denmark.
Nice.
Yeah, so they're white like the snow, but they actually do need a shower or a bath.
Ma, did you bring them over on a boat?
No, they actually came on the plane.
On the plane, wow.
Yes,
how did you get through customs?
Yes. They made it safe through customs in Darwin. Yeah.
Well, you could smuggle drugs in there.
And they went like this in Darwin. Yeah, they got the rat visa.
Did you? Where did you fly?
Tiny little girl.
The door was open here, and I don't know where the cats are.
And she was supposed to get married with an echidna. But she didn't like to be in the dark, so, and then in the end she married somebody who was collecting butterflies.
Oh, lovely.
Yeah, and she's so tiny that she lives on a little leaf, like the water lily leaf.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's the story about her.
And what's her name again?
Tomalisa.
Some roses putting and Arthur. Yeah. Good teamwork here.
I need to put them in.
Putting the rosella seeds in.
Did you guys see those? I dropped the last seed saver in the packet of empty beans. There was like because there was like a two beans ported up because I arrived late last time, so I didn't get them.
Hi. The pomegranate is good, man.
I've got two chairs there, and I've got the blanket around the corner.
Yeah.
And then the shop was crackly, it was crackly, and October. I just cut the drive back, and I was really bushy. I think I need cleaning every now and then. We had some on.
Yeah.
I think the secret is to
start at 6 and go to about 11:30.
But you don't know what happened.
So yeah, it's just too hot.
With my daughter's idea. She wanted to do this three-night cruise out of Adelaide for generations of girls.
No one has to film you.
Our subscription is $10 for a single person and $15 for a family. But if you're not we welcome anybody that's not a member. It's just if you're not a member, we just expect you to make a donation towards any seeds you might make. If you're a member, all the seeds are for free. And we have a meeting every 2 months. And we have a donation for the coffee and tea, the little dishes on that table. somewhere to have the meeting in 2 months' time. And also, I just have to announce that us and Noelle and Peter have been keeping all the boxes to do with Seed Savers, and I'm not going to do that anymore. So we'd like somebody here or one or two people here to start taking some responsibility in the club. So it's about three boxes, and I'm happy to take the seeds back every Monday because we go to the health shop every Monday. The health shop in Mareeba is good enough to keep our seeds in the room where they keep their spices, which is air conditioned. And but nobody can access them between meetings, but she's good enough to keep them for us.
And,
so I'm always happy to take the seeds back on the Monday because we take orders in on the Monday. Nice to put up before every meeting. Thank you so much, Coco. And Coco also does all the emails for us as well.
Oh, fantastic. We have to applaud her. Ula, I didn't know that you were stopping, Ula.
I'm happy to come to your place, Sarah.
Yeah, we can still, we're going to have a carpooling at our place again at 9.
Everyone's all good with Karina?
Yes. We love kuranda.
Thank you, Sarah. It's been great to see your garden. We haven't had a meeting there yet.
No. So I'd just say about the taking the box, the seed box to and from is okay. So who would like to put their hand up to update it as well?
What do you mean by that?
So what happens is that today we have packed 11 different seeds. But in between meetings, I used to update the seeds, and there used to be a seed list so that everybody could easily see how many or what seeds we have. Then you roughly know what you've got in the box because you've got a list. And then if somebody takes the last packet of seeds out, they go to that seed bank coordinator and say, I took the last packet, and so we cross it off the list. So it's not a big job, it's just a... It's a really nice job to know what seeds we got, actually. And then, you might even take a couple of the seeds yourself and put them in a garden. And that's another thing that I would like to say, that box of seeds, there's too many seeds, eh?
That's what I was gonna say, you're getting more and more
There's too many, and you know where the seeds should be?
In the garden.
In your gardens!
Yes. And also there's a giveaway table over there, so we'd like everything that's on there to be gone by the end of the afternoon. And also at the back of the attendance book, when you write down you've taken the DVD, it's all made in Papua New Guinea.
Made in a whole lot of various different islands, South Australasia.
So we have got their books for sale, and we've got their DVD to rent. Please just ask her questions when we're walking around because she's a little bit shy.
Yeah, I won't bore you too long with something you might not.
We'd like you to.
Not everybody is interested in spices and herbs as well, but herbs we can grow really well, spices we can grow some, but not all of them. I got mainly interested when we were traveling, and the food was fantastic. We usually eat in very local, very street food or whatever, in very local, very small restaurants, and the food is amazing in lots of places. And then you wonder what the spices are, and usually when you ask people, they're very willing to tell you what they do and how they do it. The first interesting things we ate was in Yemen, which is on the southern end of the Arabian Peninsula. Yemen has a very varied climate, from 3,500 meters high villages to African like desert or plain desert on the coast. It's very tropical, so they have mangoes at the same time as they have grapes and dates and all that sort of thing. And we were invited a few times in the local places called Sana. And there was one dish which is a very famous dish there, and it looks like olive colored slime. In addition, that you really have to try it. It's a bit an acquired taste, and sort of after language problems and so on, so find out what it is. It was pure fenugreek, which was soaked and then cooked and strained, and it tasted very salty and very strong. I've never had anything like that in my life. Just one of the things you would never think about eating, pure fenugreek.
And I said, it's really good for your digestion. It's really good. They make it part of the meals. And they had some fantastic flatbread with it and lots of chickpeas, that sort of thing. All very spicy. They can grow anything there. And then we traveled in Sri Lanka as well, which has the most magnificent spice gardens. And that's where they showed us how to pollinate vanilla orchids, which is growing here. But this year it didn't flower, just too dry probably. And so we eating in little places. You always can ask them what they do, and they're very willing to tell you, like that dish I made with a fruit that was in Bali, in a tiny little things, and I loved, they call it urab, just mango, whatever fruit you have, with a tamarind, chili, palm sugar, and salt. Because you can use varieties of mangoes which are a bit tangy. Here are late varieties which don't taste so sweet, but it's sort of, it's not a dessert, it's a side dish. That was one thing I really liked. Again in Sri Lanka, the food was extremely hot. All a mixture of spices. It's usually not one single spice. They use a combination, and everywhere you eat, it's always different. And curry powders don't exist in curry paste. It's all, you know, it's all homemade and home ground in a mortar and pestle very often. I have a spice grinder, but mortar and pestle is fine. So they use a lot of cinnamon. We can grow that. Cardamom, we can grow, but it's a very slow process. Somebody has cardamom. How is it doing?
Yeah, Adam cut it back and killed it, so we got some more.
Oh no.
But yours has a fragrant leaf, isn't it?
No, yeah. We got both.
You got both, yeah.
Yeah, that's and the real cardamom.
The leaf one's good for cooking with if you wrap it, and the other one is the one that Adam tried to kill.
Yeah, and the real cardamom is very, very slow to grow. It takes 5-6 years to make a seed pod, and the flower has to be is on a separate stem. So ours hasn't flowered yet. It's very slow, especially dry years. It likes it humid. And, so cardamom is used a lot. Cinnamon, of course, probably one of the main mainstays. Cardamom and cinnamon, pepper, cumin. Cumin is used a lot. I've tried to grow. Has anybody tried to grow cumin?
No.
I've tried a few times. I've got a little plant with little seed on and nothing. Black cumin, nigella. You can grow that. Didn't grow enough, but it will grow here during the winter. It's a nigella, like the flower, has a small seed pod with quite a lot of seed in, so that's one you can grow, and it tastes a bit like cumin.
That's a black seed, isn't it?
Black seed, yeah, they call it black cumin, but it has nothing to do with cumin, actually. And then there's fennel seed, like in India, when you go somewhere in Nepal as well, at the end of the meal, they have a little dish with fennel seed, and they say it's really good for digestion if you eat a few fennel seed afterwards. And what always is really nice, it's the combination of seed. Everywhere you go, it's different. Then you can ask them to use this and that in different proportions. You just have to try it out, and it really makes food more interesting. Even if you don't like hot food, you can put a bit less chili in. I use the chili fresh most of the time. What we can't grow, I buy at the health food store. They have really good herbs, good spices, and keep them in the fridge because they lose a lot of the fragrance. And cinnamon, you don't buy powder, you just grind it. Mortar and pestle is okay, and spice grinder. And I just make a little jar full of different mixes and keep them in the fridge. Keep everything in the fridge or in the freezer because they lose a lot very quickly, actually. And written about the single spices. I have a book there with healing spices and another book there with spices, and they tell you this spice is good for this, and I won't go into that, you can drink it up, and that spice, but they never write much about the combinations of it, and I think it has a lot to do with how they are combined and what they do for your body as a combination. I mean, you're not going to make a dish, a spicy dish, with only cardamom in, or, you know, there's always like 6 or 7 spices in, and up to 30 spices sometimes. So I'd love to know how the combination works. And when we ate really hot food, we actually felt really good after, even in a very hot climate. Myanmar, another one which has a really, really spicy food, is close to India. And it was about 44 degrees when we were there. And you feel really good as long as you drink enough and have spicy food. It's great. And we never had any problems really. And not everybody likes spicy food. And then you can leave the chili away and still use all the other spices, and you get something fragrant. Oh yeah, another thing. So in Yemen, Yemen used to be a wealthy country. They had in prehistoric time already frankincense and myrrh, which was traded all over the world and was very precious. And even now in the souks you find mountains of frankincense and myrrh. I brought some home. I wasn't sure that I get to show quarantine that you can do it. It's a resin which gets tapped off the tree. And we slept in an old shower house in the old sauna. And there's always someone going through all the rooms with smoking frankincense at least once a day, which is really lovely. So the whole house smells of frankincense, which is a very spicy sort of fragrance.
Beautiful.
And in Nepal, in the mountain, they did it with juniper, because that's the only thing which grows there. Yeah. And the oldest woman in the house there has to, very old, very often the grandmother has the function of going through all the rooms with a little incense burner with juniper in. Some really nice things which are not exactly spices but still attached to it. I think the whole lot is interesting, spices and incense. And the herbs as well, of course. The herbs are better known here. You can use them, you can grow them, you can't grow all of them. Because sort of I really buy herbs, just use the ones we can grow. But the spices are a different story. I mean, eventually we hope to have enough cardamom and that sort of thing. Cinnamon. With the cinnamon, you have to grow them a few years and then cut them. And that because you need a straight shoot to peel it. So in Asia, they do it every certain year. Apparently, you cut them right back, they plant them very close. And then you let sort of water shoots grow and cut them again. So it's not that simple, the whole curing thing. Vanilla grows really well if you pollinate it. Thick flower this year.
What do you use of the cinnamon? Is the bark, is it?
Yes, but it's not the outer bark. So you have to wait till it's reasonably coloured, not green and not hard bark. And then they cut it lengthwise. We have seen it in Sri Lanka. And the outermost bark is taken away. And it's the inner bark which gets that rosy, browny colour afterwards. But they put it in the sun till it peels open and then it's cured in the shade. I have never done it, but you can read up about it. So it's not the outer bark. So when you scratch, you can see, when you scratch our cinnamon tree, but it's a big shrub, you would not be able to get any stray pieces out of it. And I planted another one, and it will be cut back then and at least try to build.
Okay.
They are easy to grow from seeds and really hard to grow from cuttings. Limbalos nursery usually keeps cinnamon. They also have cardamom, I think. And cloves. The clove is still struggling. It's just not quite the right climate, I think. And the clove, where we have seen it growing, they're really scraggly trees, but it's constant moisture. It's and higher altitude, but they're not a nice, lush sort of tree. It could still be grown here, but maybe better a bit more closely. Kuranda, or just somewhere where you have more humidity, or gelatin, or something like that. But we'll still try. It's a tiny little thing I can show you, and it's sort of every year. It's few little shorts and doesn't really do much. Does anybody have one growing?
We've got 10.
Clove. And they grow well?
Yep.
Yeah. You water them a lot?
Yep.
Yep.
Yeah. And what's your soil?
Sand.
Ah, right.
With
compost
mixed through.
Yeah, ours is in that sort of blackish clay down there and it seems to struggle. Lots of things grow better in the sand. The vanilla is, once you know what to do, you have to hand pollinate it. On the coast they do set a bit, but they all get pollinated by hand. And it's a bit fiddly, but once you work out what to do, it's quite easy. And just for yourself, you can let the vanilla bean on the vine till it's black, basically, and fragrant. There's nothing ever attacking it or eating it. And then you just have to dry it slowly in the kitchen, not in the sun. Commercially, they pick it when it turns yellow. And then they pack it in cotton wool or something at night and put it out in the sun during the day, and it takes a month. So it's a bit hard. Mine were a bit too dry because we were away, and you can still use them, but they shouldn't be that dry and woody. So it's not that you have to dry it out and just fiddle a bit with it. There's plenty of information on the computer.
What about turmeric?
Turmeric is easy to grow.
Yeah,
oh yeah, ingredient of all the Asian food.
Right.
What makes the curry, when you buy curry powder, what makes it yellow is turmeric.
Right.
Any, and recipes which have saffron, I just use.
It's very expensive.
Yeah, and also it has a different taste, but turmeric, if you have it in the garden, why not use it? Turmeric you can grow, galangal you can grow, kenkor you can grow, Chinese case, they're all spicy roots. Mm.
Can you say anything about kenkor?
Kenkor, yeah.
Yeah, do you know anything about that?
Yeah, I've had a plant there. It's a low growing, like a ginger-like thing with pink flowers. The root is small, but it's quite spicy. Grows easy. Goes dormant for a long time. But kenkor, yeah.
Do you know how it's used?
Just in like ginger or turmeric. But it's, you don't get, they're small rhizomes, you don't get a lot of. It's quite spicy. Same as galangal, a bit, not huge. Our galangal gets a bit bigger, rhizome, but we had very dry weather, so the galangal is a bit woody. But the kenkor I had in pots, and it's, you can plant it out, but it sort of gets lost because it's dormant for about 7 months. So.
Right.
Yeah, you can grow it wild, especially where you are. I got some spares. If you got, you know, I got some spares in. So if anybody's interested, you can have a plant or something. Yeah, where you are, you can probably grow cinnamon and cardamom a lot better too, and cloves. Yeah. Nutmeg, forget about it. It's very tropical, humid. It takes about 20 years to bear. And it's dioecious, that means there is male and female trees. So on the coast, yeah, but not here. It wants it fruit. Have you seen the allspice trees? I've got some more up there. They grow well here. Again, that are issues, but you can use the leaves. The male will not make fruit. The female will set fruit even if you don't have a male. So if you have two or three, they flower all the same, can't have a difference. If it sets fruit, it's a female, doesn't it's a male. Oh yeah, you can use the leaves. They're like a bay leaf, they're fragrant. The berries, you pick them before, when they turn from green, just turn from green to bronze, and then you pick them. Because if you let them ripen to black, they're sweet. Mm-hmm. They grow well here. They come from Jamaica and apparently from a bit higher altitude. They do really well here. Even on the clay, they do well. Yeah. This is a really hard clay here. They're not possible. They are lily-billy type thing. They belong to lily-billy, syzygiums. So they are easy to grow compared to the cloves, which is a pain. Same family, but different. You can crush it. It tastes really, it smells really nice. Yes. Ours is very well drained. It sits on the clay, and up there the nursery I got some. They don't get more water than once a week. They come from an island, Jamaica, which is probably quite long range, I would say. It's rocky, and they don't like good soil. They don't need good soil.
Lovely. Mary, I cooked it up with
So what do you do when you dry the leaves and you powder it?
No, I don't. No, they lose the fragrance. Just use them like baby support fragrance. Yeah, or crush them for something. Lots of curry. Crispies have allspice as well. So originally came from allspice, but the trade around the world has been for a long time. I'm quite happy to eat fruit very plain, just as it is, but spices do make it interesting. I think they're good for you, especially the more tropical you go towards the equator, the spicier the food gets. And it must have some sort of reason. People have done that for thousands of years, probably. It must have some health benefits, all the combination of spices, even if you don't know. You can look up, you know, each one, what it does, but not what they do together. And the food is great. I mean, it's really fantastic what we have. It's always different because they never buy, you know, mixed spices. They make it themselves. And you can always ask those people who eat street food, whatever you ask them, little guest houses, you just ask them what they put in and they will gladly tell you. They don't tell you how much, you know, they just... And I don't weigh them either, you just make it a bit different every time. Makes it more interesting. Anything else you want to know?
Pepper.
Pepper.
So you've got your vine and you've got your tree. Thanks, two different things.
Yeah. If you buy mixed pepper, there's usually the red ones are from the Spinus, from the pepper tree. They're peppery too, you can use, or they're pink.
So from the really big tree?
From the tree, yeah. And there's the pepper, the vine, there's also different pepper. There's even an Australian native pepper.
Yeah, we have seen that in Malinda Tourist Centre.
Yeah, there is a native pepper. And we have one growing. It was a bit too dry too.
Yeah.
But they do grow well here. We have quite a bit, but not, you know, not a huge quantity. But if we look after it a bit better, it will probably get enough pepper.
So who asked about pepper? Are you talking about the vine or the tree?
Guys,
the vine.
The vine.
Yeah, they do grow well. They need, well, we have them on a mango tree, and the last year it hasn't done fantastic. I think just the extremely dry weather, and I mean, if you water them, it's different when it rains. But yeah, you should be able to grow it really well. As long as it has a shady tree to grow on, like the noelle.
When do you harvest the because I've got it growing and the seeds producing?
Yeah.
But when do you harvest the seeds?
Yeah, I wasn't sure about that either. I waited till they go red, really dark red, but apparently you have to pick them when they're green.
Yeah, green.
They get too sweet after they lose the spiciness.
Yeah, about a year ago I did try and
Yeah, you have to pick them green. When they're green and full, then you pick them and just dry them in a, you know, in a basket somewhere, and not in the sun. You can put it in the sun, but then you have to shift them in.
And do they go red after you pick them when they're green?
No.
No,
black.
They go black. But I have picked red ones too, and you can. And the tree, the pepper tree, they are red, pink.
Yeah.
And you can use them both. So,
And how about people use the pawpaw seeds?
Yeah, I was just going to say that.
It has a different taste. It's sort of cressy, like cress. But
peppery.
You could, yeah.
Mix it in with the other pepper berries too.
Sure.
The pimento, I think you may have mentioned it, but does that go by cutting?
Grows by seed a lot easier. Yeah, you can grow. I have some, because there's male and female tree, I have grown some seedlings. They grow very, not fast. After a year, you have a plant with about 8 pairs of leaves. So and then you can graft them if you want the female. But that's not too difficult in the summer. But you can grow the different things, but it's a lot easier to grow it from seedlings.
What are you talking about?
Pimento. It's not seedlings.
What's pimento?
For allspice.
Oh. Pimento, yeah. I wouldn't, it's a bit slow to grow them from cutting, they don't all take, it's a bit like cinnamon, it's sort of a hit or miss thing, but they grow very easy from seed, every seed will come up.
And how do you know if they're male or female, when does that determine?
When they flower and set seed, the one that sets fruit is female, the one that doesn't.
Okay, that's what I was wondering about,
identical.
Cutting.
Okay. And the female does not need the male, it will seed by itself without, it's one of those rare. There's a few plants which do that, so the female will not need the male, just some sort of.
Yeah, it must be a bisexual, basically.
I can't see the difference in the flower, you really would have to, they self pollinate. And the male has just flowers and drops, so you will know you have a male. You can still use the leaf, but I would recommend plant more than one. The first tree we had about 20 years ago were just three seedlings, and they turned out to be females and one male, and I was just lucky.
And how long, roughly, will they take to get to flowering?
About 6 years.
Okay.
From seed. Cuttings will probably go, and the grafted ones, they go quickly. They do take a while. But they're not the fastest growing thing, so they take, you know, the first 2 or 3 years are really slow, and then they take off.
Okay.
They're not a very big tree, they're sort of undemanding, and just like a lily pity, basically.
Right.
But allspice and wood apple, you can't clean the seed and wash it and plant it then. It doesn't seem to germinate. It needs that acidity from the pulp. Because in nature, it will probably just fall on the ground in a wet season and get covered with leaf litter and then germinate. The acidity from the pulp will probably act as a germinator.
Hey, Noelle, could you tell something about the wood apple?
Oh, yeah. Do you know the wood apple? Well, it's a beautiful tree. And we were in Myanmar, Burma. And have you ever seen on TV that the woman paint their faces with a cream-colored, yellowy-colored paste? And it acts as sunscreen. And the men as well, but the men don't seem to do it in public, they do it at home. And the women, they all have that on top. And we were in central Myanmar, which is a desert area. And all the women had that, and finally sort of our guide worked for UNESCO, planting trees in the desert there. So he knew what the tree was because I thought, oh, what is it? And he said, it's the wood apple. And they cut a branch. So I said, oh yeah, it makes those woody fruit. Because I knew the botanical name, and he could tell the botanical name. Then I knew we had it. And he said, no, it doesn't make fruit. The thing is, they never let them grow. They cut them all the time. They coppice them. Then they use the wood. I just peel the bark off, and all they do is rub the wood on a rough stone and add water, and it feels like sunscreen or skin cream. It's beautiful.
Wow.
So I can show you the tree. I got an odd young tree, they're very, very slow growing in the beginning, but then they really take off. So yeah, when you travel, you always, especially if you look at trees, you say, oh, what is that?
And,
you know, I don't know
and
that.
And then we were in Sri Lanka, we had it as an refreshing drink.
Oh yeah, the wood apple makes, when the fruit falls down, it's not that big and very woody, and when it falls down and you get it fresh, it tastes a bit inside, it's sort of a pulpy thing. They make a drink, it tastes a bit like tamarind, it's quite acid. So it's a beautiful tree.
You have to be poor and desperate to do it, but it is interesting.
Well, they usually add some palm sugar or something. It's very acid, it's like a sour tamarind. But when you're thirsty, it's good. Yeah. It's also a very nice tree, I think it's a top tree. But we had it for a long time and I never sort of associated with the Tanaka, what they call the, you know, and it really is, it's like a skin, it's like a moisturizer, it's beautiful. It's just water and bark, and wood, not bark.
Do you use it now, daily?
No, I haven't cut it back. You need, because when it has all those little branches, you don't want to kill the tree, and I'll have to wait and cut the branch off, but it's such a shame because it's so beautiful.
That's her husband.
You should too.
Men don't do it, they do it.
Yes,
no,
they do it, they
it.
Told us. The young guy, he said they do it, but not when other people see, they do it at night time. They don't want to be seen like a woman with face paint.
It's a secret.
Oh, yeah. That's the sort of things which are the interesting things when you travel. You sort of because when you ask people, they're always very willing to tell you. I've never met anybody who said you're not in business and they don't tell you it's a secret. It's,
but I think the magic of Australia is, I was just talking about it before, that 40 plus years ago, people said, oh, now there's nothing here, you can't grow much. You can do anything in Australia, it's wonderful, it's very special.
But they told us you can't grow tropical fruit tree on the western side of the Great Divide. That's what we heard. Now they grow the best mangoes here, the cashews, and you name it, and avocados. And now don't even try, yeah? That's sort of out.
It's still a funny country, Australia, really.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a very varied country.
A bit odd.
We're getting there.
A lab in somewhere, and she's putting heaps, hundreds and thousands of spices in. And she told me that there's two types of turmeric, we knew that. We used to grow the yellow one, which on the computer is really, they call it a white one, and then there's the orange one. And we found that when we took the yellow one to the market, nobody would buy it because it wasn't orange, it didn't look like turmeric. So we've been deleting that from our garden and just concentrating on the orange. And she said she wouldn't dream of putting the white one, what she calls the white, which is yellow, into the food, and it's a bit bitter, but we've been doing that for years. And so they only use that one for drink. So they get tamarind, fresh young tamarind leaves, and then grind up the yellow turmeric. And get the juice out of it and then mix it with water. Cutting, instead of cutting the whole bunch, he's just been cutting one hand at a time. And then we've got bananas nearly all the time now, which we've never even thought to do this in 40 years. And the bottom hands are all filling out a lot more than before.
What do you mean by not sharp? I don't know.
Well, that's bananas, you don't let them ripen on the bunch because they'll be all cracked by then.
Yeah. Sharp edges. Yeah. They haven't filled out.
So with bananas, you usually cut them when they haven't got the sharp edges anymore.
Yep.
So when that happens, you can, Michael's just been cutting the first one or two hands, bringing them inside, and then cutting another hand the following week. And he's finding that all the bottom of the bunch is really filling up and getting fatter. And you can, if you only just got a small garden and you want to have bananas for longer, it's really working well for us now. Because before we would wait until you might see one ripe banana or, and then we'd have three bunches already at the same time, so that's just a hint.
If you want that hand to ripen quicker, you put a ripe banana in airtight,
In
and it'll ripen
bag.
In about 3 days.
Or Granny Smith apple in a paper bag.
Well,
yep.
Thank you.
it's not
pretty quickly.
Her family, do they have a laptop too, computer? Oh, sorry.
It's a salvia.
High, isn't it?
Bloke from Kuranda gave me a plant.
Yeah, they are around. It's not a big plant.
No, about that size.
Oh, well, they are only 3 months old.
Yes. Uh-huh. And he gave me a few durians to sell at the store too, which are this big.
Wow.
I've tried a couple. I was never going to plant a durian in Mareeba,
yeah.
But I saw one growing in Fruitopia,
yeah.
And on the red hill opposite to where we used to live, Jones has got, Lloyd Jones, he's got a tree that's been bearing.
Oh, wow, yeah.
That's exciting.
Wormwood is a pest. Yeah. I never plant wormwood. I have to get it. Yeah. It was like a tree and it went everywhere.
God, look at it all, hey? Yeah.
Amazing collection.
Yeah. Where's it all going to go, though?
A lot of them grow out into the bigger garden, and then she, I think people buy them.
Oh, okay. She sells them, does she?
Yeah.
Lisa, look at this.
A fruit on it already.
Alright.
Amazing.
Do you want the southern one?
Yeah, yeah.
That's the little red fruits that were in the salad.
Oh, yeah.
Summer.
Got one, yeah. So wait, do you have an edible?
Edible fruit. That is one that in the wet season doesn't do well. Even if you keep it in a pot, that's gone.
Yeah, I get so much rain, it's like...
How big does that sandalwood grow?
Did you smell it?
I do have a lot of time.
Look at this one. The fruit. The fruit
that's
is bigger.
That's another one, that's even smaller.
That's a different one.
Yeah, it's a different one.
The fruit is bigger than the plant.
I've got that growing and that's a cutting, so I can't help myself if you have to make cuttings if you see something, you know.
Yeah, oh, that's cute.
Oh, it's very cute.
Yes. What's this?
Angelica. Amazing. You have to go out for 1.5 years. And I was just like,
so how strong is it?
And,
you
can't plant
it. I have no idea.
Same sort of look, you know?
Yeah, so here are things which should have been planted out, and I was ready for rain, and then I grow some, they're gone.